Hi. So the subject I was asked to discuss is the concept of sola scriptura juxtaposed to how the church understands scripture. So as you're out here in this American world, in the evangelical Christian world, there are certain presumptions that when you engage, when you discuss things of faith, you might be using the same words as somebody else, but it has a completely different meaning, the way you understand it versus the way they understand it. So what I'm hoping to convey is basically an understanding of things as they are in the basis of them, and then an understanding of the differences and what the ramifications of those differences are. I don't know, have any of you really gotten into, say, theological discussions with American evangelicals? Anybody? Okay, and typically what you're going to hear is them giving verses of scripture for why they believe what they believe. And it's a thing that I've come to call the game of verse versus verse. So here's my verse, and then you have your verses versus my verse, and then, well, what about this verse? And it just becomes, I've found, a futile way to approach it. You're really not going to get anywhere because the tens of thousands of churches are indicative of the numerous ways people can understand these various passages. So what I'm going to do is actually back up a little bit. What I think is important is to understand the larger question, the framework question, before we get into the specifics. So is anybody here familiar with the term sola scriptura? Okay. So we've got a couple of people. Can somebody give me a definition of what that means and what the context when it was first introduced and what it meant in that context?
So as I understand it, sola scriptura basically means that your faith comes from the Bible alone, and the scripture is all you need for basically salvation. And it primarily developed sometime in the 16th century during the Reformation, specifically through Martin Luther's rejection of Catholic teachings.
This is actually very close, and this is really kind of a good definition of how it's understood today. But it's really not, what it actually is, what was just defined, is more solo scriptura, which is how it tends to play out. But sola scriptura is a little bit different than that. And here was the question. You had the Catholic Church, and you had these people within the church who were looking at these abuses. People who relied on, well, I go to church and I partake of the sacraments, and between Sunday afternoon and the next Sunday morning, I live pretty much ignoring God. And they are seeing some abuses going on in some areas, in some of the hierarchy of the church. And they started having some objections. And they said, no, you know, the Bible, the scriptures, and the church traditions, and the popes and what they have stated, together make up the absolute truth of God. And in response, because they're looking at some of these leaders and saying, you look pretty corrupt to me, and if all you've got is a Bible and a church, but you're looking at a lot of the people that you're seeing are corrupted, I guess that leaves you with just a Bible. So what sola scriptura means is scripture alone is the final authority, not the only thing considered, but the final authority. And in reality, it's kind of come now to be the only thing considered, more what was defined here, solo scriptura, but that's not really how it was understood. So what I want to actually back up to is the basis, because what is the question when we talk about the Bible and the church, tradition and the Bible? What is the underlying thing we want to know? It's what is truth, right? What's true? And so I think this is where we need to begin, is with that question. So truth itself, when I say what matters is truth, what is truth? Remember Pontius Pilate, the famous question, what is truth? Can anybody here give me a definition of truth? Okay, I'm going to give you a little somewhat complex one, the best one I've ever heard, which came from Ravi Zacharias, who's just a brilliant philosopher. And he said, truth is that which propositionally corresponds to its referent, which means this. Truth in this manner of use of the term that we're talking about is a proposition, a statement. I say, this is a chair. Okay, this proposition, this is a chair, refers to an actual reality that sits right here next to me. Are you guys following what I'm saying? So the proposition is here. This is the reality. Now, if that proposition matches that reality, then it's true and it's truth. If I say this is a dog, then the proposition did not match the reality. So now that is not true. And so in our context, the bigger question of truth is essentially, what is God, what are we to believe, and what are we to do in relationship to God? And so this is the real question underneath all the other questions. And the answer to that is either corresponding to God properly or it's not. It's either true or it's not true. And so I think it's important that we distinguish between a statement that may be true and the reality that the statement is discussing. So let's talk about, we understand Christ said, I am the truth, right? I am the truth, the life, and the way. Well, in this, what he's saying is, I am the reality of truth, not the proposition that corresponds to the reality. I am the reality. Do you understand the difference? So I can say, this is a chair, and that's a proposition that refers to the chair, but the chair would say, I am the chair. I am the reality. The proposition isn't identical to the reality. It cannot necessarily encapsulate the reality. So let's look at Christ as the truth. Well, his essence of who he is in himself. Is there any proposition, any statement that we can make that encapsulates and is truly identical to the reality of Christ in himself? Who he is and how he knows himself, who he is in himself, his essence. Is there any statement that we can make that actually completely matches and encompasses that reality? Well, the answer is no. That you cannot have any proposition that equals the reality of Christ as he is. Everything that you are going to say propositionally is going to be an analogy of the truth that is Christ. So Christ is the truth. He's the embodiment of truth. And anything we say about him, we are saying things that we understand, ways that we can relate to the reality that are an analogy to the reality. But they're not the reality. He's the reality. So everything we say has to necessarily be in an analogical form. So there are limits in this. So how do we begin to understand truth, God? Who is the truth? Well, you start to have these analogies. Like I said, propositions are one form of analogy that tell us some things that are true but don't completely encapsulate it. Some others are icons. Those are non-verbal, non-spoken analogies of the truth. They give us in image form that which is as close as we can get in image form to portraying, to grasping, to understanding. It's not that they're not true, but they're limited in their truth that they can convey. just like our propositions that we could say are limited in what we can say. So let's say God is love. Well, yes, we're making an analogy to something we understand, which is love. But the love as it exists in God, as he is himself and knows himself, we can't fully grasp that. So we have something that is as close to grasping it as we can get when we say love, but it exists in him in a way that is infinitely beyond our ability to truly grasp. Well, in icons, we have another form of conveying that which is true, but also cannot fully grasp and encapsulate that truth. So here God has man cut off from himself, and he's wanting to connect back to man, to convey himself to man, to have communion with man. And so we have images that were given. We had, in the Old Testament, we had a tabernacle and then a temple, and we had images in the temple. And we had these various things to give us pictures as we were able to understand God. And what you find very interesting in the Old Testament, there's actually a progression going on there, because God is going to you where you stand and saying, okay, in your context, this is how you can begin to understand me. And so he's dealing with this little nomadic people out in the middle of a desert that are rather primitive. And so he's coming to them in a form that they're able to get some understanding of who he is, which is the law. He comes to them with the law of Moses. Now, as you notice in the New Testament, it says kind of the law is finished. Well, I would hope that the law, you shall not murder, is absolutely irrelevant to everybody in this room. I really hope so. That if there were no law that said, you shall not murder, you still wouldn't murder, because you have the image of God and this awareness of God. The law should become irrelevant to you. But to this early nomadic people, there was law, and God says, okay, from where you are, this is some way of you can kind of understand as much as you're able who I am. And if you notice over time, kind of the image of God that they're given goes from this wrathful, you do as I command, or you're going to suffer some serious consequences, to as you move forward in time, you get into the time of the prophets and you see him dealing with issues like social justice and caring for the poor and the weak. And you see this progression. Well, it's not God who's growing up. It's not God who's becoming more mature. It's people who are. Until finally, humanity gets to the place that they're able to be ready for a more complete revelation of who God is. So here you have God conveying himself in icons, in propositions, in imagery and sacrament and a sacrificial worship system. And now we are coming to the point where the most complete image of God, who he is possible. And what is that image that he gives us that's the most complete image for us to grasp who God is? Christ. Right. God in the flesh. But understand, God in the flesh is still icon. It says in the scripture that he is the icon of God. So even at that you can touch him and handle him and interact, the essence of what he is within himself, you still cannot fully grasp because you are not equal to him. But it is as far as we can go in truly coming to understand him, and that movement into understanding him more and more as he is in himself, that's, I believe, an eternal progress, an eternal movement towards the center of who God is, and you will always be infinitely away from that core, but always moving closer to it. So here we're finally given the ultimate icon, which is God in the flesh. He speaks the things he says, the things he does, the care he shows for people, the everything about him is, this is God. In as much as you will ever be able to understand him, here he is. And so through this progression of humanity and preparation, we finally get to the culmination of the revelation of God, which is Christ, which is Emmanuel, God with us. Now, if truth is a person, then how we come to know truth is not just through propositions and statements. It's through experiencing that person. And there are means that are given us to experience the person, not just hear propositions and statements about the person, but to interact with the person and begin to experience the presence of the person. Not that propositions are irrelevant, but there are different ways of knowing and understanding truth, which is person. And experiencing is one of those key ways. And the way that we have been given is through humility, diligence, holiness. These are ways we can come to know the truth more and more. It's kind of interesting that in the early church, you couldn't just come forward and be baptized. You had to live the experience and life of the church. And they believed the way you come to know that it's true is by living it and experiencing it, where it's really kind of opposite of what the American church culture says, whereas you believe it and then you will experience it. There it says, live and experience it, and you will come to know for certain that this is true, that he is truth. So this is a very fundamental difference. So we have a number of sources to obtain truth. Experientially, we have through prayer, diligence, humility, icons, scripture. We have a vast array of resources given us. Fasting, you know, the ascetic practices, numerous ways. So we understand how this sola scriptura was born. But remember we said before in our teaching that how we came here was actually through a study in the canon of scripture, how we got the scriptures themselves. That was what turned our attention to this early church and made us kind of really start looking at this and investigate this early church. So some things we found that were rather alarming to us, because we kind of have this idea in America that, well, the Bible just kind of fell out of heaven or something, or it was this book the church just always had, and that God gave us this as the sole revelation, the sole absolutely infallible revelation of who he is. So what are we doing? What are we doing with that book when we put it in this way? Are we not making an idol of it? Are we not making it equal to God? Are we not treating it as equal to God? Rather than an icon of God, we're treating it as if it is God. You see, understand the difference? We're acting as though everything that God left for us to govern over the church, to teach the people, to impart himself into humanity, the one thing he left us that is absolutely reliable to connect us back to him is a book. Understand the role we're giving to this book. We're giving this book divinity, when in fact there is a divinity presence, but it is an icon. The Bible is an icon. It's a verbal icon. It's an icon in words. So it's an image of God in word form. That's an image of God in the form of various media, and a visual icon rather than a verbal icon. You understand what I'm saying? That there are different icons. And to place one icon on this level of being equal to God and not understanding this cannot encapsulate God. No icon can. God is God. The icons point to us, to him. They give us images of him, but they are not him. He is the reality, not the icons. The fact that as human beings, we are able to communicate an icon, whether it's this icon or verbal icon in the book, is just fascinating. it's amazing that humanity can do this. I don't know if you guys think about this. I can make vibrations in my throat and noises come out and take a concept that is in my mind, pass it through the air in this room, and it vibrates these tiny little bones in your ear and sends a signal up to your brain, and you receive the same picture I had in my mind. That's just amazing. This is the communication in the form of icon. This is what he's given us, all these different ways to communicate with each other and to communicate through to him to give us pictures and understandings.
Saints?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Oh, well, I was just saying also saints are icons, that when we look at their lives and we look at, I mean, not just, you know, the written icon, but when we, as Paul said, imitate me as I imitate Christ. So we can have icons in our abunas or in each other as well.
And so back to our first picture, we had in the West some corruption in the church, in a holy book, and so there came this Reformation. Now, during the course of the Reformation, one of the things I find very interesting is they were very careful to agree with the canons that came out of the early councils of the church. The Trinity, the hypostatic union, these early councils. And these things, which were very disputed and really were only established in this form of expression centuries after the church began, but they were careful to keep in line with those basic things. But there are many things that were never disputed by anybody, from which there was a pretty serious departure, because they weren't mentioned in the councils because everybody was on the same page. There was no need. There was no dispute that ever happened in the first place. So it is rather ironic that these things in these councils, if you'll notice, came about hundreds of years after the church began. And in all honesty, if we looked at something like, say, communion, is that the body and blood of Christ? Well, there's in the evangelical church, the answer is no. And in all of the churches, and there was never a dispute, that's why it's not in a council, you had, yes, it is, the body and blood of Christ. But it was never laid out in a council form because everybody knew it. There was never a dispute. Yet there are other things where it was like, yes, hold the council. As a matter of fact, the issue of the Trinity, you would actually have better historical basis for being a Jehovah's Witness saying Christ is not God than you do for denying the body and blood of Christ in the sacrament. Because there you actually had a pretty big division going on for decades of battling back and forth between Arius and the Orthodox. And finally, after decades, Athanasius Contra Mundum, he won, and the church won, and the heresy was finally ended. But you at least have a vast number of people for decades believing this, as far as what the Jehovah's Witness believe about Christ, but you don't have anybody with the issue of the sacraments on the other side of the aisle. So kind of what I'm saying is, although it's said sola scriptura, there are other things that are presumed upon that are kind of irrationally presumed upon when you look at the other things that are rejected that are more solid. So how did the canon, this Bible, how did this come to us if it didn't fall out of the sky? Well, where do we find the first list of which books should be the official, trustworthy, holy books? Where's that first list found? Anybody? Athanasius in 367? No. That's the list that we have. That's the first place we see our list. But the first list of which books should be set apart are from Marcion, the heretic, the Gnostic, around 140 AD. And his canon consisted of edited versions of Paul's letters and a chunk out of, I believe it was Luke's gospel. I think it was Luke's gospel, an edited version of Luke's gospel. And all the other stuff, he said, was the Jews had slipped all this other stuff in about law and all that. And, well, that didn't belong in the canon. So his was actually the first proposed canon. And famously, Polycarp, seeing Marcion in Rome, and Marcion said, "Don't you recognize me?" And he said, "Of course, I recognize the firstborn of Satan." And it was very clear in rejecting Marcion. So the point is, this Bible, to say this alone is trustworthy, did not exist for centuries. As a matter of fact, nothing had been written for decades. You have a church born, apostles going out and teaching, establishing churches, and nothing is written. And decades later, you start to have some things written. And you start to have Paul writing quite a few letters addressing specific problems within a church. That's the point. And then you have false stories going out as far as what Jesus did and said and taught. So you have the need for the church to say, you know what, we need to make an official writing of the things that the eyewitnesses saw, and those are the four gospels that we have. But those were sent out as individual things. They were never compiled as a book. There was never an understanding that a book was going to rule over the church. The book was not even a book as a collection of these for centuries. What you had were individual writings, and various churches had some. You'd be surprised to find Revelation really almost didn't make it. And you know, we're the only church who reads from Revelation on our calendar. And you guys all know when we read it, right? On right Saturday, and we read the whole book. But we're the only ones. It almost didn't make it. And there were other things that didn't make it and almost did. And the idea, though, that really struck me when I was learning how we got our Bible, the thing that floored me was, and this is from a brilliant, accepted, world-renowned Protestant theologian who basically said they weren't searching the scriptures to find out what was true. They had truth in Christ, and the embodiment of truth was there in front of them in his teachings, and the things he did was truth. They were looking back at those scriptures through the lens of Christ and seeing him all over. That's what the early evangelism was. They were taking out the Old Testament writings and saying, look, here's Christ. Look, here's Christ. Here's Christ. Here's Christ. All the way through. This was the early evangelism. But they weren't searching the book to find out what was true. They had truth. They were looking through the truth at the book and understanding. Huge difference. And I often say, as a matter of fact, as we go fast forward to the time when the church is going to finally codify a canon, I often mention that in the West, we as Protestants search the book to find out what's true. But they didn't. They didn't have a book a few hundred years later. They had various writings, but not just these writings. There's the Epistle of Clement. There's the Didache. There's tremendous writings that people who knew apostles, Ignatius's epistles, that are absolutely true, and they had certain criteria to figure out which ones are we going to put officially. But instead of looking at the Bible to find out what was true, they looked at the truth to find out what was Bible. They looked to the liturgies. They looked to the creeds and the early proto-creeds. They looked to the confessions, the baptismal confessions. They looked to all the things that were at the core of their life and worship. And they started measuring these writings against those things. So they already had the truth in Christ. But now it was time to determine which of these books is going to get included in this canon. And there were numerous resources they were looking to. What has been handed down to us? That's what we need to say. What was handed down to us, and does this match it? And certain criteria were laid out to formulate this Bible. And so with this attempt to make the Bible this one source that is reliable for everything, it's really almost humorous that Martin Luther, with the sola scriptura concept, was basically dumbfounded to realize other people were interpreting it differently than he did. And it's not as though you had this one massive reformation where everybody said, yes, the Catholics are wrong and we all agree. Well, no, you had Luther battling against Zwingli, against Calvin, and all these different subgroups. You had the Calvinists drowning the Anabaptists, who said you had to be rebaptized. They said, oh, you like a second baptism? How about a third? And they tied them up and threw them in the river and drowned them. And there were wars in between all of these groups. Luther was just like, wait a minute. I thought everybody would understand what I so clearly see in this book. Well, they didn't see it so clearly. And forgive me if this really sounds less than reverent, but if I were going to write a manual on how to do something, I ride a Harley-Davidson motorcycle, and let's say I've got a manual that talks about how to replace this part, and I passed it out, and...
How do these characters affect our church? The people that you mentioned, the characters, do they affect our Catholic church?
Hold that question to the end, and I will come back to it. So you have, let's say, this Harley manual, how to change this part. And let's say I have all these different people who are pretty good with tools, and they all start doing something different and a different order of things to try and change the same part, reading the same manual. Well, you would say whoever wrote that manual was the worst service manual writer who ever lived and should never be allowed to write another service manual for anybody. It was the worst. Well, so that's exactly what's happening with the Bible in the West. So the question is this the worst service manual writer in the world? Or are you trying to use this book to do something it was never intended to do? It's one or the other. And I say, no, it wasn't intended to be a compendium of belief and worship. The way you pick up your Old Testament, go through Exodus, Leviticus, and start looking at all of these things and say, okay, I'm going to form a religion based upon these things. Well, your temple's going to be right where the Jews had the temple. Your worship, you're going to sacrifice this animal at this hour of the day. You're going to do this on this day of the year and that on that day of the year. And at this hour and on this day, you're going to do this. And you actually will be pretty much duplicating the Jewish religion by following that as a manual, because it's very detailed and emphatic. But you try that with the New Testament, and you get tens of thousands of different answers as to how to worship and what to believe. Well, that's because it was not supposed to do that. St. Paul said the law was given to us as a tutor, but now maturity has come, adulthood. The whole point of salvation history, the whole point of all of this, since the beginning, since the fall of man, was to reunite man with God, so man doesn't need a teacher telling him what to do, how to follow God all the time. Man has a connection to God. Now, it's not to say we don't have instructors around us and others on this different walk that are going to help us and along the way, but it's that we now have direct access to God and a way to truly connect and communicate with God. And so it's not that we need a new tutor to stand over us. He imparted himself into humanity, ontologically, uniting, changing human beings into another kind of human being that can have relationship with him. Now, yes, those human beings can be fallible, of course. But when they all speak in one voice saying, this is what we hear God saying, and these are the people of God, born into God, in the church, which is the body of Christ. When they're all speaking in one voice, that's the voice of the Spirit. This is the thing. Yes, individuals can make mistakes and err. And so this actually takes us to the different kinds of truth out there. We have that which is dogma. All the church has said it all the time. We've settled upon this and rested here for millennia. This is core. This is dogma. If you say, no, I'm the first person to get it, and they all got it wrong, well, you're probably the one that's wrong. It's not the church that's wrong. Then you kind of step out and you have doctrine that are very important. And then as you move out, you have what's called theologumenon, which are there were some disputes, and different fathers may say different things about this subject. Okay, and so as they kind of say different things, we know there's some room for movement here and opinions. And what we also know is these things aren't as central and core. The things which are central and core, the purpose of salvation history was for God to unite himself with man. And where does that exist? Where is God united to man? The church. And what did St. Paul say was the pillar and ground of all truth? Did he say it was a book? No, he said it was the church. It's the body of Christ. That's the pillar and ground of all truth. The Bible is an icon and an image, and it's a wonderful one among all the other icons. But the church is the pillar and ground of truth. They had scribes all over. He could have said, Shecky, come on over here, and then we're going to go over this whole list of beliefs and practices, and we're going to lay out what the liturgy is supposed to look like. But he didn't. If he didn't, that means he didn't need to. He trusted the apostles. That's why he didn't write it down, because he knew, if he's God anyway and knows the future, he says they can be entrusted with this. And the apostles never wrote a book or assembled a book. Why? Were they connected to God? I think we can all assume, yes, they knew God. We were pretty well connected. Now, if they knew, being connected to God, in the future, this is all going to go wrong, so we better get together here and write this down to make sure everything's laid out so no one can mess it up. But they didn't, which means they trusted the people they gave it to, the bishops. They said they can be trusted to hold this. St. Paul said to the Thessalonians, hold fast to the traditions you were given, the things handed down to you, both in word and in deed. Oh, I'm sorry, in written word or in spoken word. Both ways, orally and written. There was no distinction made. It was all truth. So to us, we're really not saying, well, this truth is here and this, you know, is the Bible is above all the other truths and this truth. Truth is truth. First of all, if it's true, it's true. Truth is truth. Secondly, all these forms of truth are icons. None of them can be the reality. They all point us to the reality, connect us to the reality, but the reality is person, which is Christ. And all of these things are wonderful aids, and that's what the Bible is, a wonderful aid in pointing us to, as an icon, towards Christ. But to make it alone, to sit over the church, where Luther was really trying to get rid of the Pope, what he did was created millions of popes. And now back to your question. How does this affect the church? Because within the church, we have to ask, is everybody his own pope? Which is the American thing that was born out of this. Do we in the church open the book and say, well, I think the Bible says this, and I'm going to discount them. I'm sorry, but when I hear certain controversial things kind of happening around the church, and I don't hear that much, but when I do, I'm rather astonished because the responses I hear from Coptic people are very often, well, I think, well, I feel, this is this American model where every man is his own pope. This is the issue. Where what I really want to hear is, well, you know, the fathers in this period had a very similar problem, and here's how they dealt with it. And the fathers here had something that was real close. Here's a parallel that we can draw into this situation. You see, where are we turning for the answer to the issue that's on the table? At me or at that universal voice that went before us? That's how it really affects the church. Because what the Bible has done is given us our own seat as our own pope in the Western use. And that does bleed off over into the church. And I see it in the church. Whereas, and this is a very American concept of individual liberty. And there are some good aspects to that individual liberty. Believe me, I love being American. This is, you know, how I grew up. But understand, that is not a Christian concept as far as the church. The church is not a democracy. This is...
I was just asking Tilo, there's a passage that said that, says it a couple of times, that every man did what was right in his own eyes. And we have to really look at that and understand what it's saying, that every man didn't just do as he felt, he did as what he thought was right. And so each one of those people going their own way did what they felt was right. And I think that there's the quote from Martin Luther that says, God help me. What is it? It's something about God help me, I can do no other, because his conscience was his pope. And this is what I believe that Tilo is saying, that you can be honest, you can be sincere. It doesn't have to be with overt arrogance. But there is an arrogance when we aren't seeking to hear the voice of the church of 2,000 years and the abunas that give us this voice.
So to boil it down, the fundamental difference is, in one concept, the Bible sits over the church, and each man interprets it, and as he interprets it, essentially is his own pope. The other model, which is our model, is the church as a whole is the body of Christ, and the Bible, and the icons, and the creeds, and the liturgies, and the confessions are all part of the church. They're all together parts that are working together to build the whole up. So to understand, when we have a discussion about Bible, verse versus verse is going to take you into endless futility, because there are equally brilliant scholars in every one of those camps, really smart people. And it's only when you start bringing in the voice of the whole church, what has the whole church said, that you start to narrow that fence down as to what is truth, what we can believe. And this idea, again, when you have a question, when something is coming up that affects the church, what should the church do? Well, what about bringing these songs in? What about bringing in instruments? What about whatever the question is? Forgive me this, but I often find the Copts just giving their opinions based upon their emotional reactions or how something appeals to them. That is not the way we approach things. Nor do we go find a bunch of verses that match what we already believed and start arguing our verses against someone else's verses. What we do is we look back to the history of the church. We are not the first ones here. We are not the first ones to invent this religion. It was given down for 2,000 years. So what we look for is there a precedent before us that dealt with this issue? If not, how about a parallel? Is there something that runs really close to this issue? And was there division in different groups? A great example, the chanting types. Our chanting here in the Coptic Church, I found very difficult. It doesn't match my ears. I go into a Latin church, it's beautiful. Matches my Western ear. Antiochian as well, Russian as well, Coptic not at all. But what do we know? Which is the right chanting? Well, what did the whole church say? All these different ones said this style, but what did they all say the same? They all accepted each other's and gave each other the nod. Yes, yes, yes. Yours is Orthodox. Yes, yours is Orthodox. We all agree. This area is an area of diversity, which is good, which reflects all these different cultures. This is good. How about languages we translated into? Yes, yes, all these languages. And everybody agrees, yes, this is good. But then where are areas where there are divisions that say, no, that's not okay? This should be our question. What has the church said whenever a question in life or within the church comes up? Not what do my feelings say? What did my aunt say? It's the church as a whole is where we look. And the Bible is a very important part of that church. It's an integral part when we ask the question, what do we believe or do? This is one of the primary resources we consult, but it's not the only one we consult. We consult the liturgies, the creeds, the confessions, the writings, the fathers, 2,000 years of history. That's how we do it. And as I said to one friend, the idea of saying Scripture alone is reliable, since the Bible itself was given to us by the church 300 years later, to say the church is not reliable, but the Bible is to be sitting out on a branch and sawing it off behind you. So when it cuts and breaks loose, you're going to go down with it, because it's preposterous to say we can't trust the people who gave it to us, but we can trust the product. So.
So, first of all, I think we need prerequisites at college level, the philosophy of religion. But when you go back to God and Christ being truth, that they're the source of the ultimate truth, and then the church embodies icons and the Bible and so on, how do you know at what point if the church has been influenced or infused by societal norms or values? And then essentially along the decades and centuries, then it has become the church's truth. Because right now, with our interpretation, if God is love and believe in homosexuality, whatever it is, they think it's right. So how do you know at what point does society and their norms and values, do they influence church dogma back then, and then it becomes known as truth to us?
That's a great question. And one problem I found within the Coptic Church is, because of our estrangement from the other confessions, we kind of, when we talk about the church, we mean the Coptic Church only. Well, if you want to know what is truly Christian, you don't just look at the Coptic Church. You look at the Greeks, the Russians, all the other churches. Now, let's say we all hold something together the same. That's Orthodox. Now, let's say there's something that only the Copts do. That's Coptic. Not Orthodox. There's a difference. You see what I'm saying? Now, that's not to say it's wrong. So how do we find out what differences? So it's not societal. This is, forgive me, I'm going to be a couple of minutes on this answer. Forgive me. The question is, how do we know what's cultural coming into the church versus what's the church? This is drawing a division between human expression and that which is deity. But Christ came to end that division in the first place, to close it. So to say this is a cultural thing that came in is not to say it doesn't belong or it's not right. Because if you look, all theology in the first centuries was actually in the language of Greek philosophy. All the terms we use, the concepts, the prologue to John's gospel, in the beginning was the Logos, and the Logos was with God. What that word logos, that was not invented by the church. That goes way back into Platonism, and it's this bridge between the perfect divine and the created that is the inner dialogue of the person that connects through to the other side. The whole concept was there, but the church, I loved, I forget which Abuna it was, I heard him say, the church baptized the culture. It baptized Greek philosophy. It baptized art. So it took these things that were very human cultural expressions and baptize them. And it's not that this one's from man and this one's from God anymore. Since Christ came, he came to unite man with God. So because it's human does not mean it doesn't belong. It's a human expression, icon, again, of deity. So how do we know? The other half of the question is that it wasn't a deviation from the truth, something that doesn't belong. Well, again, you look at the history of the church. If you see it there throughout, okay. If you see it showing up a bit later, but it's universally accepted, yeah. Great example, I've said this in our other talk. Augustine, the Bishop of Hippo, had a version of the Old Testament that was translated by Jerome. Jerome was a brilliant scholar, and he translated from the Hebrew rather than Septuagint. He believed that the Hebrew was more trustworthy. So when he translated it, and Augustine read the passage where Jonah sat under the thing at the end that was the gourd, it was called in the Septuagint, well, Jerome from the Hebrew decided to translate it as an ivy. When it was read on Sunday that he sat under the ivy, there was a riot in the town. So I can promise you, if something was a significant deviation, if they're rioting over calling a gourd an ivy, imagine a Buddha changing something in the liturgy. a meaning of something and reversing it and changing the words in the liturgy. I've been around Egyptians long enough to know there will be a riot. There will be people throwing dust in the air and screaming, and it will not be pretty. So you look at what is universal, what is early and universal, and these are your guides to tell you what is core, what is sustained, and what things are cultural are good cultural. They're good expressions, things that should be baptized, that are good human expression, that do belong in the church as humanity meets divinity and the two join together. But then you can look at the other churches and say, okay, but these other churches differ in these cultural ways in how they express it. Then those things should not be imposed upon each other as dogma. And I accept that. I mean, forgive me, I'm going to say this honestly. I cross my legs when I'm sitting down. And I know it's offensive sometimes. Yes, I know. But you know what? That's Coptic. That's cultural. And I'm an American. And that's who I am. It's fine. So it's when you're trying to impose as dogma that which is cultural that you have a problem that shouldn't happen. That which is Orthodox versus that which is Coptic. And I think very often some of the Coptic people don't know the difference, and it's helpful for them to learn the difference. But in order to understand the difference, you have to be able to look at all the other Orthodox churches. And that'll kind of tell you where there's room for movement and what things you can't. But, you know, one of the things to start with is always, what does it mean? Why do we do that? That's a good place to start. What's the meaning of doing this? And if nobody knows, you know, and the other ones aren't doing it, maybe you shouldn't be trying to impose it and demand everybody else do it. Did that answer the question?
No, that's very good. We could go on and on.
Just a quick one. You mentioned sanctuary, or the one who translated Greek to Latin.
Hebrew to Latin. Yeah. 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 St. Jerome. Brilliant man. Is that it? No thank yous, no clap, please.
Thank you. And I think the big point is that we were saying is that we have to get the spirit of Christ, the spirit of the church, and to be able to decipher between all the other stuff that is not Orthodox or is good culture stuff and other stuff that is not. So that takes a lot of prayer, a lot of study, and a lot of questioning, which is good questioning. So may God give us the wisdom and the patience.
This is Coptic cultural.
Yes.
I find this is one of the most beautiful expressions to when I see somebody. I love this. It's beautiful what is conveyed in this, and I see what's conveyed.
Mm-hmm. So that doesn't mean we eliminate the cultural stuff that's not necessarily Orthodox because it could be spiritual. Right. So thank you again, and hopefully we'll be able to continue this same theme the next couple of weeks. Any other questions or comments? Okay, I'll stand up to pray. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, and God, amen. Our Heavenly Father, God, the only begotten Son, and the Holy Spirit, we thank you, we praise you, bless you, we glorify you. We ask and entreat your goodness, O Lord of mankind, to help us to see you as the scope of all Scripture, as St. Athanasius says. Help us to see you, the author and the finisher of our faith, the one who imparts unto us your reality through different means and different icons in the Church. Help us to see each icon and to find you through them, and to see you as the core of our being, the core of our creation, the core of what we need to be and what we need to do. Grant us your Holy Spirit to discern the rest of the spirits, and to discern what is truth, and what is the true church, and what is our true objective in this life, is to be united with you, and to be transformed by you, that one day we may hear the voice full of joy saying, come, blessed of my Father, and inherit the kingdom prepared for you since the foundation of the world. Bless us with every spiritual blessing. Bless this church. Bless every church that is called by your name and lives according to your truth. Through the intercession of the Holy Mother of God, St. Mary, all the choir of your heavenly saints, make us worthy to pray with all thanksgiving. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil one. In Christ Jesus our Lord, thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Go in peace, and the peace of the Lord be with you. Thank you.